been writing local history for about 5 years, in actually mostly in Perry County. You know, I just am so interested in telling people's stories. This is what I want to do. And so, you know, I'm researching along, and I keep falling over events of the time period of the mid-1700s. And you know, that was a very turbulent time period here in Cumberland County, and you know, lots of counties to the west and to the north. And so I thought, you know what, I'm going to have to do some research. And then of course I had to write a book, because I wanted to tell the stories of the settlers. So, you know, when I'm working on my book, I'm thinking the settlers and what were their experiences, not so much the military, because there's been a lot written on the military. Okay, and today we're going to talk about Alexander Logan, and he was one of the settlers in this time period. He had 1 foot in Cumberland County and 1 foot in Sherman's Valley, or what's known as Perry County today. So I thought that we'd take a look at him, see what his experiences were in this time period. Okay, so first, you know, if you're interested in researching in colonial Pennsylvania, there are actually a lot of resources. And when I was doing my research, I wanted to use original research, because there's lots of stories about what happened, but were they really true? So, and I just wanted to make a list because people have asked me, people have said, well, you know, how did you do your research? And so the Pennsylvania Gazette is available. It was published in Philadelphia, but in many, many issues, there are letters from Carlisle, you know, which detail a lot of events that happened here. Or the Pennsylvania Archives, you may be familiar with them. There are 100 volumes set, lots of information about colonial Pennsylvania, and they're searchable online. And, you know, that's really key. There are letters and journals from that time period, court records, land warrants, and so lots of opportunities for information in the mid-1700s. Okay, let's take a look at Alexander Logan. And we find him first here in Cumberland County, and he's actually in West Pennsboro by 1751, and that's the earliest tax list. And so, as a record, this is where he is. Now, of course, then West Pennsboro was one of just a couple townships. And so it was, if you draw a straight line from the northern edge of Cumberland County down to the southern edge, it's just west of Carlisle. This was the eastern edge, and just east of Newville. So let's say Carlisle to Newville was West Pennsboro, very large area. But this is where he was. And as far as I know, I could not find a deed for him in Cumberland County. Doesn't mean there wasn't one, but I couldn't find one that was recorded. As comparison, Carlisle was laid out in 1751. There were 5 dwellings in 1753, and of course, the all-important jail in 1754. So it gives you a little bit of comparison. You know, we're looking at Cumberland County right now because this is where Alexander is. There were established Presbyterian churches. And you know, that's really important. You know, settlers had been coming into Cumberland County since the 1730s. So there'd been quite a number of years to establish some Presbyterian churches. And of course, there would have been some log gristmills. So here in Cumberland County, there was civilization. So you were civilized in the mid-1700s. Okay. Now, but Alexander, he had his eyes on some land further west. And so Shearman's Valley, and you may say, well, it should not have that A in it. And people have said to me, you spelled the name wrong. And actually, in the mid-1700s, the name Shearman's had an A in it. And so I was trying to be true to the time. It was opened for settlement in 1755. And that's 4 years after the first record that we have of Alexander Logan in Cumberland County. I think he was probably here earlier. But at least, again, we're looking at records. In 1755, he crossed the Blue Mountain, or it's called the Kittatinny Mountain, and it's also called the North Mountain. But he crossed that. And he settled in Shearman's Valley, which we know is Perry County today. So he left Cumberland County and went west. The region was just open for settlement. There had been a governmental purchase in 1754. There were settlers who went in earlier illegally. Perhaps Alexander Logan went in before 1755, because on his land warrant, early in 1755, he said he had an improvement on his land, which would have been the log cabin, so he may have been there earlier. However, Shearman's Valley was not civilized like Cumberland County, because there were only scattered cabins. That was all. No mills, no churches. Okay, so you see the contrast. You see the difference between the two areas. And maybe you're thinking, because at first I thought, why would you leave? I wouldn't have, let me tell you. I wouldn't have. But, you know, many settlers, especially Scotch-Irish, because many, many people here then were Scotch-Irish, you know, it was an opportunity for land. They were not afraid to leave civilization and move into the backcountry. And by the way, you know, when I originally started reading for this time period, I thought that Frontier was a good name. And I actually, you know, I'm playing with the title, I'm thinking of Pennsylvania Frontier. Guess what? I read that the word frontier wasn't used until later. In the 1750s, people said backcountry. So we were in the Pennsylvania backcountry. Okay. So let's take a look at this map. Now this is a 1770 map. And if you look down here at the lower right-hand corner, you see Carlisle. And notice all the roads coming out from it. Here's the Conedogwinet Creek. And the reason that I chose this map was because it was the first map that had names up in this area. And this is what I was looking for. But at any rate, here you see Shearman's Valley, again with another spelling. The mountain between Cumberland County and Perry County is this ridge right here. And by the way, this map is not to scale. You know, this is 1770. Now, who's living here? Alexander Logan. Notice that Logan's plantation, as farms were called in those days, is noted on this map, which is really amazing because, you know, it must have been a place for stopping if you were traveling. And if you notice, if you're coming out from Carlisle and you're traveling up this road, probably wasn't much of a road. This was what was known as earlier as the new path. This was a trader's path. And today, I don't know if you are familiar with the places in Perry County. This is actually near a tiny crossroads named Kistler, or it's about 6 or 8 miles west of Ickesburg, or 3 or 4 miles east of Blaine. So this is where this was. Okay, so you can see he came from West Pennsboro, which would have been in this area here or further south, and traveled all the way to here. Okay. Now, he settled in 1755 along with many other people who moved out of Carlisle, moved across the mountains to what we know as Perry County, Juniata County. But that was a time where there was a lot of unease, unrest, and it was because the British and the French were vying for the lucrative fur trade. You know what? There's money. There was money in those furs. So there was a lot of conflicts that were arising. And the of course, there were settlers going across the mountain illegally. And that had been going on for some time, 6, 8, 10 years. And so the Iroquois Indians, who sort of named themselves as a negotiating group, would occasionally or would periodically complain about these encroaching settlers. They would say, our cousins, the Delawares, use this land as a hunting ground. Now, in the mid-1700s, there weren't Indian groups living in Sherman's Valley or in Juniata County. There was remnants, maybe, of a Tuscarora group, perhaps. But this was their prime hunting ground. And so they were unhappy about the encroaching settlers. And then, in 1755, it all sort of came to a climax or whatever, because Braddock and his British troops were defeated by the French and a group of Indians out near Pittsburgh. And at that point, the Delaware Indians made the decision that they should side with the French. And I'm simplifying this, by the way, because we could have a whole hour on this, and we're going to look at the settlers. And they said, we're going to side with the French because we know they're going to win. Because they did. They defeated Braddock. So they saw this as an opportunity to come east and drive the settlers out. They wanted their land back. So let's look at this. There were actually two waves of attacks, and these are all the attacks in Perry County and Juniata County. And these stars up here represent attacks in 1756. These three in Juniata County, these two in Perry County, although technically this was Duncannon. And did y'all know that there's a sliver of Dauphin County across the river? Did you know that?
Yeah.
Neither did I, but guess what? There were two islands in 1756 called Duncan's and Haldeman's Island, and they eventually became part of Dauphin County. Now, today, I think it's mostly woodland, but on one of those islands, was a family that was attacked near Duncannon. So I can't say that that was in Perry County. It wasn't, it was in Dauphin County. At any rate, these were Scotch-Irish. And you know, Scotch-Irish, they were soldiers. They were military, you know, very used to fighting. Now, a lot of them left the area because this was a dangerous time. You know, if you stayed, you were placing yourself and your family in danger. But you know what? Some of them said, we're not leaving. We're going to build forts. We're going to build forts and we're going to stay. And this is what they did. They built these forts here, Robinson's Fort, Biggin's Fort, Patterson's Fort, and they said, we're going to stay. But of course, these attacks took place in 56. By 1756, August or September, they all had gone. Everybody left. Do you know where they went?
Pittsburgh.
No, they didn't go to Pittsburgh because that was farther west, because there were still lots of attacks taking place there. They came east. Guess where? Carlisle. Now, Alexander Logan, there's no record of him being involved in any attack. He left the valley along with everybody else. We don't know when he left because there's really only records of people who were, you know, involved in the attacks. But he came back to Carlisle. Let me move on here. Okay, he came back to Carlisle. Many other settlers came to Carlisle. Maybe they went to Shippensburg. Maybe they went to Lancaster. Because, you know, Lancaster County was farther east. And so they may have deemed that the safer place to go. So can you imagine how many people were here in Carlisle, in the Cumberland County, hopefully with some relatives or friends, and were refugees? So Alexander Logan and most other settlers took refuge, and they were here for years. This was not just a couple months. They spent years here because it was too dangerous to take your family and go back over the mountain to what we know as Perry County or Juniata County, Mifflin County, Huntington County, Franklin County, wherever, you know, wherever you were living. It could be, though, you know, in the meantime, your plantation was still over the mountain. You needed money. You know, there were organizations, Presbyterian churches, that raised money to give to these refugees. So perhaps settlers would occasionally go back over the mountain in groups to check their plantation. Okay, so Alexander Logan was, guess what? He was back in Cumberland County and spent several years here. So can you imagine how chaotic it was in Carlisle and in all of Cumberland County? Very chaotic. Okay. Let me say one other thing, too, that about 1760, 61, probably a lot of settlers went back over the mountain because it was deemed safe, and so they sort of trickled back, and, you know, there were quite a number living, again, back on their plantations. However, there was a second wave of attacks, and that's what we historians call Pontiac's War. And this took place starting in the spring of 1763. And, you know, the French and Indian War had come to a conclusion. You know, the British were the victors in that area. Here in the colonies, it was known as the Seven Years' War. And the Indian groups were unhappy with how things were going, because what was happening? You know, lots of settlers coming in. You know, this area had all been sold, but other areas of Pennsylvania, lots of settlers. And so they formed a sort of a confederation to remove the settlers and soldiers. And it actually started out in Detroit. And it was a Chief Pontiac who sort of got the ball rolling. They started laying siege to forts, they worked their way east, they brought a siege to Fort Pitt, and the attacks continued all the way to the Blue Mountains. And where are the Blue Mountains, or the North Mountains? On the border between Cumberland County and Sherman's Valley or Perry County. So now we're under attack again. So the settlers left Sherman's Valley, Tuscarora Valley, Juniata County. This time, they left. They didn't stay because the danger was too great. However, their plantations were still back over the mountain. Now, we need to say that Alexander had built a strong log cabin 30 by 30 feet on his plantation. And we know that for sure. Now that was pretty large. A lot of log cabins were more like 24 by 26 or 22 by 28. But his was 30 by 30. And he must have apparently made it to be very strong. So in July of 1763, so the settlers are sitting on this side of the mountain. Everybody is here in Carlisle, Cumberland County, but the harvest was ready on their plantations. They were concerned. How are they going to feed their families? You know, they're refugees. So what they did was, the men, heads of household, left their wives and they left their children here in safekeeping, and they got together in large groups and went back over the mountain to harvest their crops in large groups. And, you know, they were hopeful that this would be okay. However, beginning July 10th, there were several attacks in Tuscarora and Sherman's Valley. So let's go back to this map now. Now, and let's look at this. And I want to say that the attacks actually started along Tuscarora Creek. And if you're I don't know if you're familiar with Juniata County, this is what's known as Mexico today. This is what's known as Thompson Town. So these attacks started while there was somebody who came over the mountain and he brought word of these attacks. So there were a group of 12 men who got together right here at midnight. And so they were concerned about all of their friends over the mountain. So the next morning, they went over the mountain here and started working their way east, and they just found burnt cabins, so on and so forth along the way. They came over the mountain and over the mountain here in this vicinity. And so there was an attack here when the group of 12 men met a party of Indians. Now that was on, this started July 10th. This attack was probably July 11th. Now, either the same day or a day later, or maybe even 2 days later, there was another attack involving Alexander Logan. And so that's what we're going to focus on today. And notice the men who are here are heads of households, or maybe, you know, young single men who've joined them. All the wives and children are away in Cumberland County. And this was different from 1756. In 1756, families stayed. But, you know, this was different. So, there was a skirmish with Alexander Logan and four other settlers and a party of Indians. Now, one account says that the Indians went first to Logan's cabin and they emptied some beds. And emptying some beds means that they killed some settlers. You know, I've wondered about that. I've not found anything else that corroborates that. I'm just not sure about that. You know, some of these accounts were taken when the person who was given the account was quite, was aging. And so, you know, perhaps there was some, you know, some mix-up. But anyhow, five settlers, including Alexander and his grown son John, followed the Indians. Now, Alexander had eight children. And so John was the oldest, so I'm assuming, you know, that there were probably a couple sons close in age to John, but he left them in Cumberland County with his wife and children for, say, again, you know, so there's some protection for them. And of course, some of the other children would have been quite young. So these five settlers caught up with a party of Indians about 2 miles west at a plantation owned by George McCord. And so it occurred at his barn. There was a skirmish, and four of the five settlers died. So Alexander died, John died. This is all in the Pennsylvania Gazette, if you're wondering. And, you know, two of the other three died. Now, are you wondering about George McCord? This was his barn. George McCord had actually died in March of that same year. This attack took place in July. And so he was no longer living. His family, his wife and children were surely in Carlisle or perhaps Lancaster, but they still knew it as George McCord's barn. Okay, but the attack was not finished. The party of Indians went back to Alexander's log cabin And they were rifling through the cabin and they shot some cattle. This is all in the Pennsylvania Gazette. And the Carlisle sheriff and his men came up. And you know, it had been two or three days of attacks in Sherman's Valley. So of course there was a lot of concern on this side of the mountain. So the sheriff, and his name was Ezekiel Dunning, they came up and they surrounded the cabin. And I actually wanted to quote a couple lines from the Pennsylvania Gazette. Because, so the skirmish began, the enemy returned their fire, they were inside the cabin. The Carlisle sheriff and his men were outside the cabin. They rushed it. The party of Indians were able to get away. They were pursued, but they were not caught. But a very descriptive account of what happened. Now, we know that Alexander and his son John, who would have been, let's say, 1920, 21, did not survive. Neither did another settler by the name of William Hamilton. And he wrote his will on July 15, 1763. So that may tell us that the attack took place maybe on the 14th, maybe on the 15th, you know, because he lingered. He lingered for a couple days. And he said, sell my property to support my wife and daughter in this time of public calamity. And so you can see how fearful, you know, how concerned, what the concern would have been here, you know, because the question would have been, are they gonna, you know, is this gonna come over the mountain? You know, are we in grave danger? Here, the other settler was Charles Coyle. We don't know anything about him. I could find nothing about him. He was probably a young, unmarried man of, again, 20, 21. Now, that was in the summer of 1763. So, what happened? Carlisle became one of the places for the refugees. Again, Shippensburg. Many refugees at Shippensburg, and I'm sure, again, east at Lancaster, in Lancaster. But here is one point that was made, that Carlisle was the barrier. You were the last point of defense, and every stable and hovel in the town were crowded with miserable refugees. So, a very, very difficult time. And then later, as the winter sort of, you know, moving into spring, another quote from the newspaper, you know, people have been here for the winter. They have sold their cattle if they were able to, you know, have some animals with them. What are they going, you know, what are they doing? And, you know, to survive. And again, there were organizations and churches here, Philadelphia, perhaps other areas that took up collections to help the refugees. Now, believe it or not, and I was so surprised to hear about this, but there were troops stationed north and south of the mountain. So let's take a look at a map. Now, let's see. Here is Sherman's Valley, right here. There were troops stationed. Okay, here's the mountain, the North Mountain that divides Cumberland County and Perry County. So troops here. And the person who, you know, drew up the map gave the name of the person who owned the plantation where the settlers were, or not the settlers, the soldiers were stationed. So this is present-day Elliotsburg, if you know where that is, which is about 6-8 miles west of New Bloomfield. So there were soldiers stationed here.
Excuse me, where was that?
This is Elliotsburg.
Elliotsburg.
Yeah, this is Fisher, was Samuel Fisher, who was living here, or at least he wasn't here at this time, but this was his plantation. here at Groves. This is, was Jacob's Grove Plantation. This is very close to where Alexander Logan's cabin was, and there were troops placed there also. But look, look at all of these troops placed at the foot of the mountain. You know, all along the mountain, clear out, you know, to Fort Loudoun, which is in Franklin County, out in Path Valley, and here at Shippensburg, there were troops, and of course, here in Carlisle, there was, you know, governmental troops, and, you know, and the fort, and there were troops there. But, you know, this map was a revelation to me, to think that for this year, winter of 1763, perhaps most of 64, there were troops in Cumberland County, and also Perry County, Franklin County, and it's because the government, you know, the town of Carlisle, provincial government, didn't want, you know, any attacks coming over the mountain farther east. Now, believe it or not, this map is wonderful. There's no text that exists about this map, only the map. And, but fascinating, just fascinating.
Where did you find the map?
That map is online. Okay, I've 90% of my research I did online for this book. And it is in, it's published in a particular book, and you know, I have a reference, you know, I have the reference in the book that I wrote. Okay, by the end of 1764, now there's been troops, you know, in this area for a year. Colonel Bouquet took an expedition into the Ohio Valley, and the Ohio Valley then was Pittsburgh, points west into Ohio. He returned with more than 200 Indian captives, although there were likely many more who did not come back. You know, the Indians, you know, the Indian camps agreed to give up the captives, and, you know, Colonel Bouquet agreed that he would not destroy the Indian camps. And so now the situation started to moderate, and so settlers now felt that it was safe to cross the mountain. This is after this is 1764. So 1766, there are six or eight churches in Perry County, Juniata County that were established. You know, a few early grist mills. These were the last of the attacks in 1763 in this area. Now, further west and north, there were attacks much later. But, you know, we're just looking at Alexander Logan's territory here. Now, are you wondering what happened to the Logan family? Because remember, there's seven other children still here in Cumberland County with the mother. And the mother died soon after the attack. And you know, you might wonder how I know that. Guess what? It's mentioned on a deed. It's mentioned on a deed, and that the mother, you know, mentioned about the father, you know, being killed in the attack, and the mother died soon after. The children returned to Sherman's Valley. They did not stay here in Cumberland County. They went back to Sherman's Valley. They were raised in the area, and then they moved on to Kentucky and Tennessee, as many of the Scotch-Irish did. You know, they didn't stay in one area very long. They moved. Now, the sons sold the center of the Logan Tract to George McMillan in 1785. The McMillan family still owns the tract today. The seventh generation of this family is still on the farm. Isn't that amazing? It's really cool, let me tell you. So because it was the same family, we know that Alexander's log cabin stood until the early 1900s. And from time to time before that, you know, some of the McMillans or perhaps someone they knew would dig out the ounce balls for prize possession, because the sheriff and his men, when they came up to the cabin after the skirmish, and they were shooting into the cabin. And so people, locals, dug out those prized balls. Now, of course, I talked to Clee McMillan, who owns the farm now. It's a working farm. And he said that, you know, and of course, this is all recorded in the McMillan family history. The cabin was torn down very early in the 1900s. He said there is no picture of it. No picture. And he says, you know, surely somebody would have taken a picture. But for years, the McMillan family lived in a cabin in the 1800s. And that's how they know that it's 30 by 30. That is the reason that they know. Cleve believes, he has a wash house on his farm. It was built in the early 1900s. He believes that wash house was built on the site of the log cabin. You know, this is what his thinking is. Now, let me tell you, Alvin McMillan, who was probably about the third or fourth generation McMillan, in 1896, he was clearing out a nearby property. Now, you know, again, this is close by where Alexander Logan lived, and in the heart of one of the trees was a perfectly preserved scalp with fine silken hair. And that was 130 years after the attack. And that's just amazing. But the reason that we can sort of trace the history of the Logan family or their property after the mid-1700s is because the same family is still there. And you know, when the same family stays somewhere, you know, the history is easier to preserve the history. Now, of course, you know, I had to write this all up and put this in a book. And as Linda said, also, we talked about Alexander Logan, and the account of his skirmish is one chapter in this book, because all of the other chapters refer to the other attacks that took place in 1756 and 1763. And if you are interested, I do have some books here today, as Linda said. So, thank you very much. So, does anybody have any questions?
Well, I do, of course.
Yes, yes.
My research leads me to believe that after the attacks in 1756 and maybe in 1763, the Indians came back and burned everything. So there were plantations there, but there may have not been standing houses and farms.
Yeah, and you're right about that. There were a lot of places that were burned. Now, and Alexander's log cabin in 63 was not one of them. It was not burned.
Yes, but we don't know that the one in 63 was the same one because nobody kept the records.
Right, except that, you know, when the McMillan family bought that, you know, that I think it's a strong possibility that it could have survived. But you're right.
It could have. It could have. Some others are known.
Yes. Yes, there were a lot of buildings, structures, etc.
So the idea was to drive the whites out of the area.
Yes. Yes.
So you are disrupting their economic base by preventing their harvest and burning their real estate.
Right. Absolutely. Yes, sir.
You referred to it as Cumberland County and Perry County, but weren't they all under one county name?
Yes, you're absolutely right. And over the next 40, 50, 60 years, you know, the sections became, you know, other counties. And Perry County was formed in 1820. So, I was saying today, Perry County and Cumberland County, just to help people know where we were geographically. But you're right. And in this time period, the area that's known today as Perry County was Sherman's Valley. And the area that's known today as Juniata County was Tuscarora Valley. and so on and so forth. But yes, you're absolutely correct. Other questions? Yes?
Do you happen to know anything about the early life of Alexander Logan specifically? Was he related to James Logan?
You know, I wondered, and so I did some research. Alexander Logan was here with his father and brother, so, you know, so we know that. And, you know, I tried to look at James Logan's lineage, so I didn't find any correlation in the 1700s. It doesn't mean that there might have been not have been a, you know, a correlation earlier, but Logan was, you know, it's a more common name, you know. Okay. All right. Well, thank you very much.